In this video, we learn how to calculate the escape velocity from a planet. In other words, the minimum velocity that it takes to escape the gravitational force of the planet. So in this first animation, we're looking at a failed attempt where the velocity wasn't big enough, and the mass just crashes back into the surface. But as you can imagine, using a bigger initial velocity will result in a larger maximum distance, and eventually you can shoot this mass with high enough initial velocity that it will never return to the planet. So in the animation, we can see the mass is slowing down here as gravity does negative work on it, but the mass is never coming back and just escapes to infinity. So the minimum velocity it takes to escape the gravity of a planet, that's what we call the escape velocity. And in this video, we're going to calculate it and then find the escape velocity specifically for the Earth. So to get kind of a foundation for this problem, we're going to start by looking at the energy issues surrounding the problem of trying to shoot an object off the surface of a planet fast enough so it never comes back. So on the right side of the screen, we have an energy diagram. In other words, a picture of the gravitational potential energy between these two masses as a function of separation distance between the masses. Keep in mind that by separation distance, we mean center to center separation distance here. And our gravitational potential energy function is given by the result negative g big M little m over r, where r is the separation distance, and I'll post a link to the video where that was first derived. Note that this potential energy function is always negative, but that's okay because it's only the changes in potential energy that are actually physical. We can tell from the graph that the potential energy goes down as the separation distance decreases between the objects, and it goes up as the objects move farther apart, and that makes good physical sense. The other thing I want to point out about this graph is that the radius of the planet is going to be our smallest possible separation distance. So I put a cut line in the graph there, indicating that the smallest possible value of the separation distance, little r, is big R. Now note that we're going to use the approximation that the radius of our little mass that we're launching is negligible compared to the radius of the planet, so that the initial separation distance actually is approximately equal to the radius of the planet. Now the first thing I want to do here is consider the case where the total energy, in other words, the kinetic plus the potential, is negative. So there's our total energy, and that's a horizontal line because it's constant. Energy is conserved when we launch our tiny mass off the surface, so as our separation distance, little r, varies, that total energy is just going to stay the same. And I want to draw attention to a special point in the graph, the intersection of the total energy and potential energy. At this special point, the potential energy is equal to the total energy, and that means the kinetic energy must be zero. So that means we've located the maximum R value where the kinetic energy is equal to zero, and the object has to turn around at that point because it's stationary. And in fact, the formal name for this point is the turning point. So we can use this point as the starting point for constructing a graph of the kinetic energy as a function of separation distance. We just start at this zero point. Then as r becomes smaller, the potential energy goes down, and the kinetic energy must go up exactly as much in order to keep the total energy constant. So our energy diagram for this negative net energy case is complete, and we're ready to run a simultaneous animation to see what this process looks like physically and what it looks like in the energy plot. So our mass shoots off the surface and slows down. Then it starts running out of kinetic energy. Again, the minimum value of kinetic energy is zero, and that's when the object has zero speed and turns around. And then we crash back into the planet with the same amount of kinetic energy we started with. So next we consider what happens if the total energy is positive. So starting off on the right side of the plot here, we can infer the kinetic energy by making sure the kinetic and potential energies add up to the total energy at every point. Well, with a small negative potential energy out there, we must have a positive kinetic energy a little bit larger than the total energy at that point. And that guarantees that when we add the two energies, we get the correct positive value of the total energy. And we work our way to the left again, making sure the kinetic energy increases just as much as the potential energy decreases. And we get our plot of kinetic energy as a function of separation distance. So let's run a simultaneous animation again, this time with positive net energy. Note that the kinetic energy is asymptotic now to the total energy of the system, meaning this time the mass is free to run off to infinity, and it maintains a positive kinetic energy forever as it runs off to infinity. In other words, it still has some non-zero speed after it escapes the planet's gravity. So, now we're ready to talk about the special cut point that gives us the minimum escape velocity from the planet. That's the energy required to run off to infinity, but run out of kinetic energy as the distance grows to infinity. In other words, we're talking about the special case where the total energy of the mass is zero. Note in the energy diagram that the kinetic energy is simply a reflection of the potential energy about the r-axis, guaranteeing that the total energy is always zero now. So, as the animation progresses, we see the mass slowing down, and in the diagram, we see the kinetic energy function approaching zero from above as potential energy approaches zero from below. And this mass is going to run off to infinity with its speed approaching zero. So when we launch at the escape velocity, the mass escapes the gravity of the planet, but just barely. All right, now we've figured out that the physical key to this problem is to let the total energy of the system equal zero. And we're ready to just compute a general formula for the escape velocity. Once we get that formula, we're going to apply it to our own lovely planet and see what kind of speed we're really talking about. So again, the physical key to solving this problem is to realize that our total energy must be zero, and that's the kinetic energy plus the potential energy. So the kinetic energy as we're launching this thing off the surface of the planet, that's 1/2 mv². And the potential energy at that moment is given by negative g, big M for the planet, little m for the mass that we're launching, over their separation distance. Well, we're launching from the surface of the planet, so that's a separation distance of big R. So all of that has to add up to zero, and we'll get to that special cut point where this mass can escape the gravity of Earth, but have its velocity approach zero in the large R limit. So the first thing I want to point out here is that we can divide the little mass out of this equation. That means the mass of the thing that we're launching doesn't matter. No matter what size it is, it has to reach the same minimum velocity to escape Earth. And our goal is to solve for v, so we're going to add gm over r to both sides, and then multiply it by 2 and take the square root. So the first thing we're doing is adding that to both sides, then we multiply by 2 to get rid of that 1/2, and then we square root the result to isolate v. So there's our general escape velocity from a planet, the square root of 2gm over r. So next, we're going to calculate the escape velocity from Earth. And here's where I have to admit that we're simplifying this problem significantly by ignoring the rotation of the Earth here. And it turns out that in practice, the rotation of Earth actually plays a practically significant role. This is actually why most launches occur near the equator. But as a first approximation, let's just pretend the Earth is a non-rotating perfect sphere. So in our table of data, we're given the mass of the Earth as 5.972 times 10 to the 24 kilograms, the radius of the Earth, 6,371 kilometers. We're going to need to put that in SI units. So making that conversion real quick, this is 6.371 times 10 to the third kilometers, but then when we change to meters, we get another factor of 10 to the third. So we have 6.371 times 10 to the sixth. Meters. And then there's big G, the universal gravitational constant, as 6.674 times 10 to the negative 11 newton meters squared per kilogram squared. So we'll just plug into our escape velocity formula. And as I do this, I'm going to keep the units this time just to make sure everything checks out. I'm going to give myself plenty of space there. And in our numerator, we have 2 times G, and then we have the mass of the Earth, and we're dividing all this by the radius of the Earth. And when I run the numbers on this, and I'll just go ahead and keep 4 significant digits since all the data came to us that way, I get 11,190 meters per second. Now I do still want to check to make sure all the units are working out here. So I have meters squared up here in the numerator. That's going to cancel one factor of meters down there. I have a kilograms here and a kilograms in the denominator here. So I end up with units of newton meters per kilogram inside of a square root. We should probably verify that that actually comes out to meters per second. And the key to this is to remember where the newton was first defined. So we're going to go back to Newton's second law, F equals ma. A newton has units of mass times units of acceleration. So that's kilograms meters per second squared, Well, now our kilograms are going to cancel out. And then inside the square root, when I multiply the meters into that numerator, I end up with meters squared per second squared, which when I take the square root becomes meters per second. The last thing I want to mention here, for those of you in the US, is that this 11,190 meters per second converts to roughly 25,000 miles per hour. So if we manage to launch something at that speed, of course, ignoring the rotation of the Earth and atmospheric drag, and probably 10 other complications, that's the cut line for an object to escape the Earth's gravity forever. Again, the rotation of the Earth is actually going to make a practically significant difference to this result, because that can give our object some kinetic energy before we even launch it. In the next video, we're going to approximate exactly how much of an advantage we can get by taking advantage of the Earth's rotation. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.